The intent of this video is to discuss the B-29 bomber tail gunner's exterior features, interior compartment, and the station's combat effectiveness. This image shows the various B-29 bomber crew positions. The tail gunner cavity is in aircraft section 45. The gunner is in the aft section of the bomber, facing backwards. He is responsible for protecting the back end of the bomber and the formation from tail attacks. The B-29 bombers were pressurized, heated, and insulated. The B-29's pressurized compartments are shown here. The cabin's differential pressure level is set to an 8,000-foot cabin altitude. This is the same cabin altitude pressure level as a commercial aircraft. The tail gunner is in an isolated pressure section. If hostile action is anticipated, the bomber will depressurize to minimize a catastrophic pressure vessel rupture. The crew members will don their oxygen masks when depressurized at altitudes above 10,000 feet. The tail gunner's pressurized section is shaded in this view. Let's take a look at the outside of the tail gunner station. The fuselage is constructed as a stress skin semi-monocoque construction where the skin is the main load-bearing component and the internal frames and stringers help share and distribute the loads. The loads are transferred from the frames and stringers to the skin by flush head rivets. The skin panels are fabricated mostly from a 24ST clad aluminum. A pure aluminum layer is roll bonded on to the stronger core aluminum alloy. This gives the panel a shiny appearance. The skin panels are butt joined to the adjacent panels with flush or countersink rivets. This construction method was adopted to minimize aerodynamic drag. This external cutout supports the APU or putt-putt exhaust. This is the aft lower turret. The aft lower turret is controlled by the side blister gunners. The hole between the barrels is the turret's camera port. The B-29's tail skid is retractable and articulates into the fuselage. It protects the aft section of the fuselage if the plane over-rotates during takeoff or flare on landing. It extends and retracts by an electric motor. There is no hand crank backup if the motor fails. This is the size of the tail skid's well cavity. This is a B-29's tail position light. Above the position light is the ammo chute. The machine gun spent cartridges and links are jettisoned overboard. The tail guns are twin Browning AN M2 50 caliber machine guns. The gun barrels are spaced 14 inches apart. The B-29's tail turret has an arc travel of 30 degrees up, 30 degrees down, 30 degrees to the right, and 30 degrees to the left. That's the same arc travel as the B-17 bomber Stinger style tail guns. Earlier B-29 models adopted a 20mm center tail cannon. This feature was discarded due to limited 125 round ammo capacity, ballistic differences between the 50 caliber bullet and the 20mm projectile, weight, and combat effectiveness. This March 1945 20th Bomber Command newsletter directs the installation of a third 50 caliber machine gun on all B-29s. Most of the World War II B-29s maintain the dual 50 caliber tail gun configuration. This image reflects the features and components of the B-29 bomber's aft and tail section. The shaded section is the crew entry door. The tail gunner will make his way from this door to the tail gunner's compartment and close the body station's 1110 pressure door. The shaded section is the tail gunner's compartment. These are the tail gunner's ammo boxes. The rest of this section is not part of the pressurized compartment and is not accessible during pressurized flight. In addition to the three panes of ballistic glass, the tail gunner was well protected by the 1144 armored bulkhead. I'm moving through the B-29's aft section towards the tail gunner's compartment. Passing by the two-cylinder, four-cycle, 5-kilowatt Andover APU generator, or putt-putt. This is a system that caught fire during the Keybird's B-29 Greenland salvage attempt in 1995, moving around the starboard side of the lower aft turret's ammo containers. The crew member will now have to crawl over the tail skid well hump. The gunner will flip down his padded seat, attach his seatbelt, and connect his comm system to the jackbox. The station will also have a walk-around bottle, an oxygen regulator, ashtray, and heated suit rheostat. This image is from the tail gunner's compartment looking forward through the bulkhead opening into the non-pressurized section. Features in this view are the ammo boxes, ammo chutes, pressure and heating ducting, tail skid cavity hump, and the aft lower turret. The tail guns were sighted by the General Electric Central Fire Control System. The gunner sighted, tracked, and fired on fighter interceptors by means of an optical pedestal gun sight. The gun sight consisted of position sensors and gyroscopes, which fed data into a vacuum tube analog computer. The computer calculated a ballistic solution. The ballistic solution accounted for lead deflection, atmospheric conditions, and bullet drop. Each of the machine guns fired up to 14 rounds per second. The ammo mix was 100% armor-piercing incendiaries. No tracers were adopted to assist in aiming. The effective range of the 50 caliber machine guns was 900 yards. The gunners had a 500-yard advantage over attacking interceptors. To use the gun system, the tail gunner would, at the control blocks, flip the auxiliary power switch on. This will turn on the gun charger's air compressors and computer. Next, turn on the AC power. This is the main power switch. AZ powers the turret and azimuth. EL powers the turret and elevation. The interval between the power switches should be 10 seconds. Turn on the tail gun's camera. Rotate the computer switch in. This starts the gun sight's gyros. When ready to shoot, switch the guns from safe to fire. Turn on the gun sight's light and adjust the reticle brightness. Dial in the interceptor's wingspan into the gun sight. Use the gun sight's optical head to track and range the interceptor. Press the action switch with your left hand. Frame the interceptor's wingspan with the right side range wheel. Fire the guns with the thumb triggers. See World War II U.S. Bomber Channel's video on the B-29 gun system for more detailed information. So just how effective was the B-29's tail gunner position? B-29 bombers flew in a standard 12-plane formation during daylight high-altitude missions. This April 1945 document shows the position of the 12 planes in the B-29 formation. This chart shows the gun coverage of the group. The tail of the formation is well protected by 41 machine guns from interceptors attacking from the 6 o'clock level or low direction, and 51 guns from fighters attacking from the 6 o'clock high direction. Japanese fighters typically attack the B-29 bomber from the front during daylight high-altitude bombing missions. This April 1945 chart shows the direction of attack during daylight missions. Of the 6,000 attacks, only 16% were from the tail. 49% of the attacks were nose attacks. The preference for daylight head-on attacks is likely due to the interceptors struggling to overtake the bombers at higher altitudes of 26,000 to 32,000 feet. The Japanese fighters typically attack the B-29 bombers from the rear during nighttime low-altitude bombing missions. This April 1945 chart shows the direction of attack during nighttime missions. Of the 231 attacks, only 12% were from the nose. 60% of the attacks were from the tail. The Japanese interceptors were reluctant to attack the bombers at night. The preference for nighttime tail attacks is likely due to the interceptor's vectoring system, which puts the fighters in a position at the bomber's tail. This 65-page 1945 Declassified Operations Analysis Report outlines the combat performance of the B-29 defensive gun system. The report concludes that the B-29 gunnery system is highly effective against rear attacks. The ratio of enemy losses to bomber losses is 70 to 1 for rear attacks, well higher than any of the other B-29 gun stations. The term lost includes interceptors that were destroyed or probably destroyed. This chart defines an approved claim of a destroyed interceptor and the percentage of claims. An enemy aircraft is destroyed if it meets the criteria outlined in this chart, including fire, pilot killed, explosion, broke apart in fire, engine failure, and bailout. An enemy aircraft is probably destroyed if it meets the following criteria as outlined in this chart, including intense smoke, fire, smoke and pieces falling off, and sections falling off. The report went on to state that the claims board has taken great pains to screen and eliminate duplicate and invalid claims. In conclusion, the B-29 tail gun station was very effective. If you've enjoyed this video and would like to see more, please like, comment, or subscribe to the channel, World War II U.S. Bombers.